بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى من تبع هداهم إلى يوم الدين. Before we go ahead with the start of the topic today, which is the notes that the Sheikh put, we want to elaborate on some of the hadith that was mentioned last time regarding the dua which is to be said after the shahwat, which is as-salatu ala al-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. For verily, when the person says the salah upon the Prophet, it is from the etiquettes of saying it with the ad, meaning you don't say sallallahu ala Muhammad, but sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. And that is why we find those supplications upon the Prophet in the prayer, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. One of them or two of them were mentioned instead of the al, ala ahli baytihi wa ala azwajihi, his household and his wives, wa dhurriyatihi and his offsprings. And this is important, for verily, the azwaj, the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, and the ones who are or died before the Prophet of Allah, Khadija and Zainab, and the nine who lived after the Prophet of Allah, all of them are included in the ad. And I'm saying this because we know that the Rafidah, they don't say the al, including the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, not to say they curse them wa'iyadhu billah and say bad things about them. So the hadith, which is number one, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ahli baytihi wa ala azwajihi wa dhurriyatihi. Here, the ahli baytihi wa azwajihi wa dhurriyatihi is the al. And the al is of two types. One which is specific and one which is general. The al, which is a specific, is the one which is the household from the children, that is Fatima and Zainab, or Kulthum, Ruqayya. And also the al is from the daughters, the children of Fatima radiallahu anha, and also the wives. That is the specific al. As for the general al, we will come under it. Every person who follows the Prophet ﷺ sunnah and champions what the Prophet of Allah says, then he is included in the al. So we are also from the al. All the followers from the general al. Al means household or the people who are the followers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is what I have said, just into making sure that you understand that the one number one and number six from the hadith, it says Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala azwajihi wa dhurriyatihi. And the first one, sallallahu Muhammad wa ala ahli baiti wa ala azwaji, the rest, all of them, Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, Muhammad and ali Muhammad. Right, let's go to al-fawa'id al-muhimma fi salati ala nabi al-umma. Salat al-yalla.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Tonight, now it is first of Jumad Thani, 1438. And we are on page 74 on the subtitle Important Notes about As-Salaan ala Nabi, sending the prayers on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of the Ummah. Number one, it can be seen that in most of these ways of sending prayers on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is no mention of Ibrahim separate from his family, the wording being as you have sent the prayers on the family of Ibrahim. The reason for this is that in Arabic, the family of a man includes the man as well as his dependents. That is in the words of the Exalted in Surah Al Imran, verse 33.
You have got it?
I have got it.
Okay. Inna Allah astafa Adam wa Nuha wa ala Ibrahim wa ala Imran ala al-alamin.
Translation of the meaning of the verse: Allah has chosen Adam, Nuh, and the family of Ibrahim and the family of Imran above all people.
Also Allah says, إِلَّا آلَ لُوطٍ نَجَّيْنَاهُمْ بِسَحَرٍ.
In Surah Al-Qamar, verse 34, translation of the meaning: We sent against them a violent tornado with showers of stones, except the family of Lut. We delivered them by early dawn. Similar is his saying, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, O Allah, send prayers on the family of Abu Awfa. The phrase Ahlul Bayt, the people of the house, is also like this.
Rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu alaykum Ahlul Bayt.
That is in Surah Al-Hud, verse 73, Allah's grace and His blessings be on you, O people of the house. Hence, Ibrahim is included in the family of Ibrahim. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says,
okay, before Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, we'll go ahead. These are some of the important issues which are linked to the prayer that the author, Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, deliberately mentioned it because lots of people are not aware of them. He says the first one is that Ibrahim alayhi salam himself always mentioned with the ad. So Ibrahim alayhi salam is always mentioned with the ad, which is the case. And that is why, because the ad of the person, it will include the person himself. So if the Al of Ibrahim mentioned without the Ibrahim, then the Ibrahim is mentioned. So if the prayer says Al Ibrahim and Ibrahim is not mentioned, it includes Ibrahim. But Ibrahim, it is being mentioned in those ahadith, Al is with him all the time. And Allah says, verily Allah chosen Adam and Nuh. Then He said, Wa'ala Ibrahim. Al Ibrahim, that means Ibrahim and his following, and Ibrahim himself. So the followers of Ibrahim, and also the household of Ibrahim, the lineage of Ibrahim, which are the prophets, all of them, even including the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, comes into the Al of Ibrahim, wa Al Imran, and that is the family of Imran, and that comes from them, Isa alayhi salam. على العالمين. Also Al-Lut. Al-Lut, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made the family of Lut had to be saved, except, and He made an exception, because if He did not make the exception, his wife will go included. And because He made the exception from the Al, then we know that the wife is from the Al. Because if there is no exception for the wife, we will understand the wife, she will be included in those people whom Allah Azza wa Jalla saved. So when He had made the exception from the Al, we mean that's a very strong proof to say that the wife is from the Al. Also in the Prophet of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, O Lord, pass salutation, salli, ala Ali Abi Awfa. This is a family of a companion. Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa, well-known companion. Ibn Abi Awfa, he's known by. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Hud, he said, Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, alaykum Ahlul Bayt. So Ibrahim in Ahlul Bayt is included. Right, now go to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah.
Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, most of the versions have, as you send prayer on the family of Ibrahim, and as you send blessings on the family of Ibrahim, some have Ibrahim himself. This is because he is the cause of all prayers and purifications on them. The rest of his family are secondary recipients of all of that. To show these two points, both wordings have been employed separately.
So we say that very few statements which mentions Ibrahim on his own. We haven't seen it in ours because it's all of them. It includes Ibrahim and Al. If it's not Ibrahim on his own, then the Al. But Ibrahim on his own, there isn't mentioning on those. But there is narrations. Some of them are, or most of them are unauthentic. Let's go now to the question which the Shaykh is want to deal with.
Further, there is a well-known question among the people of knowledge about the nature of the comparison in his statement, as you sent prayers on. For it is true that the model of comparison is normally superior to the one being compared.
Meaning, when you say, verily, O Lord, pass salutation upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just like you passed it upon Ibrahim alayhi salam, that is automatically understood that Ibrahim alayhi salam is better, because you are adding or comparing or supplicating or asking. That is, all just like you have made barakah upon Ibrahim, make salah upon Ibrahim, make it upon the Prophet. So meaning in this, that is, Ibrahim alayhi salam is better. So he's tackling this question, and this question is, you know, the scholars are different regarding it so much. And Ibn al-Qayyim is going to be seen, inshallah, he had mentioned most of those sayings. Now,
Here the opposite is the case. Since Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is greater than Ibrahim alayhi salam, and so his superiority dictates that the prayers requested are more excellent than any prayer received or to be received by anyone else. The people of knowledge have provided many answers to this.
Okay. Ibrahim alayhi salam, no doubt, he is the Khalil of Allah, as the Prophet is Khalil of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no doubt that he is from the lineage of Ibrahim alayhi salam. But we have no hesitation to say that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is better or more closer to Allah than Ibrahim. The reason behind this is the Prophet himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Ana Sayyidu Adam." I am the most eminent of the sons of Adam alayhi salam. Wala fakhr. And it's not to do with the pride. I'm the most eminent on the day of resurrection, Yawm al-Qiyamah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the one on the day of the Shafa'ah, is the one who is fit for asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to stop the reckoning, to start the reckoning and stop the agonization where the sun is too close from the people and the people running from one prophet to another. Each prophet, he says, verily, I'm not fit for it. Maybe I will be dropped into the fire. So each prophet had said that, except for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even including Isa alayhi salam, who had said no sins. All of them mentioned some sins, except for Isa, so they did not mention a sin, but yet he said, I fear upon myself that I will be dropped in the fire. So that shows us, in another narration as well, the Prophet Isa salam, he said, go to the one whom his sins, the past and the future, been forgiven. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the most eminent amongst all the prophets, with no doubt. But in terms of our belief that there are prophets, it has to be the same. Just as much as we believe the Prophet Muhammad is a prophet, I believe the same strength that Prophet Isa is a prophet, and the rest of the prophets are also. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is definitely better than Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibrahim and Muhammad, may peace and blessings be upon both of them, are from the Rusul who are called Ulul Azm. There are five prophets which are called Ulul Azm, starting with Nuh alayhi salam, and then Ibrahim, and then Musa, and then Isa, and then Muhammad, may peace and blessings be upon all of them. So let's now see what is the answers of the scholars regarding the salutation that we do in the prayer. O Lord, pass salutation upon Muhammad and his Al, just like you have passed salutation upon Ibrahim and his Al. It entails somehow a misunderstanding, which is that Ibrahim is better. Go ahead.
The people of knowledge have provided many answers to this, and these can be found in Fathul Bari and Jala al Ifham.
Al-Afham.
They amount to about 10 views, all of which are unsubstantiated, some weaker than others, except one, a well-supported view and adopted by Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah. This view is, the family of Ibrahim alayhi salam includes many prophets. None like them is found in the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Therefore, when prayers on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his family are sought similar to that bestowed on Ibrahim and his family, which includes prophets, the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam receives out of that what is appropriate for them. Since the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam does not reach the rank of the prophets, the extra blessings and benefits given to the prophets, including Ibrahim alayhi salam, are left to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Thus, he gains a distinguished position which others cannot reach.
Right, before I explain this word, just let me add something which I have forgotten to add, which is regarding the verse that we have said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحَ وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَآلَ إِمْرَانَ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. Here, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, Muhammad is from Ali Ibrahim. Muhammad is from Ali Ibrahim. So that is an addition to show us that Muhammad is from the Ali Ibrahim. Can I just ask, do you have any footnotes before that we have missed, which is important, or we don't? We don't, huh? Just to make sure that I'm not really missing anything. Your footnotes are not to do with Nasa'i, or just to do with more. No? You haven't?
No. Because it's just the wording includes Ibrahim and family of Ibrahim.
Yeah, well, this is important as well, because here, this is to do with the what? This is the supplication we have mentioned before. Okay. So, this is an addition which is from Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Muhammad is from Ali Ibrahim. Now, we're coming to the explanation of Ibn al-Qayyim rahmatullahi alayhi. He says, verily, Ali Ibrahim, they are the prophets, all of them. Ismail and Ishaq are the two sons of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And from Ishaq, all the prophets descended except from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And from Ibrahim, from Ismail alayhi salam, it's only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, in those prophets, there isn't the family of Muhammad. There isn't in the family of Muhammad like them. I mean, the family of Muhammad are not prophets. Fatima and children of his, and also the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also Ali ibn Abi Talib and the son Hassan Hussein, none of them is a prophet, and none of them can be better than a prophet. So, when it's been asked for the Prophet ﷺ and his al for his family from the Salah, just like what is Ibrahim ﷺ and his al, where they include the Prophet, then and the al of Muhammad ﷺ, they don't have prophets. So if we ask to pass salutation upon the Prophet ﷺ and his al, just like we are passing salutation upon Ibrahim and his al, so we are requesting to the Prophet and his al what being requested upon Ibrahim and his al, whom are the prophets. So the Prophet ﷺ's al will get to them something which is more, you know, than what they are, which is because they're not prophets. And he says, and the extra bit, which is for the prophets and for Ibrahim, all of it will go to the Prophet ﷺ. So the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is having his own salutation, plus the salutation of Ibrahim himself and his al. So the Prophet of Allah, his al, will get all of that. And the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ will get more than anyone. That is the most strongest saying regarding the interpretation of Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, Ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ali Ibrahim.
Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says, this is the best of all previous views, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is one of the family of Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam. In fact, he is the best of the family of Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam, as Ali ibn Talha has related from Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma about the saying of the Exalted in Surah Al-Imran, the same verse, Allah has chosen Adam, Nuh, the family of Ibrahim, and the family of Imran above all people.
Sorry, it is actually been mentioned here, called Ibn Abbas, because in my asal is the other way around. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen Adam, now Abdullah ibn Abbas says, now.
This is the text for the fact that if other prophets descended from Ibrahim alayhi salam are included in his family, then the inclusion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi salam is more fitting.
Ibn Abbas says Muhammad from Ali Ibrahim, yes?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Shall I read that?
Okay.
Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam is among the family of Ibrahim. This is the text for the fact that if...
This is a text. I mean, the text from Abdullah ibn Abbas. Go on.
The fact that if other prophets descended from Ibrahim alayhi salam are included in his family, then the inclusion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi salam is more fitting.
More priority. Now.
Hence, our saying that, as you send prayers on the family of Ibrahim, includes the prayers sent on him and on the rest of the prophets descended from Ibrahim alayhi salam.
Right, so this is a second saying as well. Okay, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is from the Ali Ibrahim. So the Prophet of Allah is getting that, and the first saying is to do with the Al of the Prophet is not as good as the Prophet's, so they will get the blessings whereupon the Prophet's been sent. Now,
Allah has then ordered us to specifically send prayers on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his family.
This is specifically, as much, yes?
As much as we send prayers on him, along with the rest of the Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam's family generally.
And he is amongst them.
Therefore, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's family receives out of that what is appropriate for them, leaving all the remainder to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Basically, all of that, it means that when we say, may Allah send salutation upon the Prophet and his Al, just like you have said, sent it upon Ibrahim and his Al, it doesn't mean that Ibrahim and Ibrahim alayhi salam is better than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it doesn't mean as well that the Al of Muhammad is better than the Al of Ibrahim, because the Al of Ibrahim has prophets in them. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has his own salutation specifically to him, and also he has on top of that the salutation which the Ibrahim himself received, and his Al, and his Al includes whom? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now,
there is no doubt that the total amount of prayers received by Ibrahim alayhi salam's family with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam among them is greater than that received by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alone. Therefore, what is sought for him is such a great favor, definitely superior than that sought for Ibrahim alayhi salam. Hence, the nature of the comparison and its consistency become clear. The prayer sought for him with these words are greater than those requested any other way, since what is requested with the supplication is that it be as much as the model of comparison, and that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam receive a large portion. The comparison dictates that what is requested is more than what was given to Ibrahim alaihi wasallam and others.
By the way, this is in Arabic, even though it is a bit long, so please excuse that the English language is going to be more complicated.
Hard, yeah.
Very hard. Now,
reading this, I got yeah, really lost
I know.
Time.
I know.
I was preparing and then I got lost time. Thus, the excellence and nobility of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over and above Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam and his family, which includes many prophets, is evident and is as he deserves. This sending of prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes evidence for this excellence of his, and this is no more than he deserves. So may Allah send prayers on him and on his family, and send peace on them, many greetings of peace, and reward him from our supplications better than he has rewarded any prophet from his people. Oh Allah, send prayers on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and on the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as you send prayers on the family of Ibrahim. You are indeed worthy of praise, full of glory, and send blessings on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and on the family of Muhammad as you send blessings on the family of Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam. You are indeed worthy of praise and full of glory.
That's Ibn Qayyim rahmatullahi alayhi. Now we come to the second benefit.
Number two, the reader will see that this part of the prayer, with all its different types, is always sending always ascending of prayer on the family of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on his wives and children, as well as himself. Therefore, it is neither from the sunnah nor carrying out the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam command to leave it at, O Allah, send prayers on Muhammad only. Rather, one of these complete types of supplication must be used, as is reported from his action sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whether in the first or the last tashahhud.
And that's underline it please, whether the first or the second tashahhud. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu.
And there is text about this from Imam al-Shafi in al-Umm, that tashahhud in the first and the second instance is the same thing. By tashahhud I mean the bearing of witness and the sending of prayers of the on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, neither will suffice without the other.
Okay. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. This is whether in the first tashahhud or the second tashahhud, there is no difference. And this is what Imam Shafi had adopted in his book, which is the So tashahhud in the beginning, in the first one, and the tashahhud in the second are to be the same. You pass salutation, just like also you make the prayers, which is attahiyatu lillah and also Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. And there is no proof to the opposite. And the proofs that is being brought, which I have dealt with a long time ago, and I don't know, I think I remember I said that to you. He says the hadith, which...
In fact, one of the most amazing things to arise from
the
this...
The hadith of Kamal Yazid, the hadith which says that he did not... you know, he did not say more than the tashahhud in the two rak'ah. Just the two lines after that, before that.
Yeah. The
hadith. You know what you just read just now, just go two lines above it.
So therefore it's neither from sunnah nor carrying out the Prophet's command to leave it at, O Allah, send prayers on Muhammad only. Rather, one of these complete types. In fact, the tashahhud in the first and second instance is the same thing.
Go ahead.
By tashahhud, I mean that bearing of witness and sending of the prayer on Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, neither will suffice without the other.
Go on.
In fact,
you missed that. There's something missing.
Missing.
Okay. As for the hadith, he did not. كان لا يزيد في ركعتين على التشهد. He did not exceed the tashahhud when he makes tashahhud. He does not exceed the attahiyyat, at-tashahhud, when he is in the two rak'ah. That means the first tashahhud. So the Prophet of Allah, he did not exceed more than attahiyyat. He did not go for the salah al-Ibrahimiyya. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. This is hadith. Shaykh al-Albani says it is munkar, which is one of the da'if. And he refers it to his da'ifa 5816. When this book was out, this da'if that he's referring to, we haven't seen the light of it. Only after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, we've seen that book, which is Al-Da'ifah 5816, which is volume number...
Death of Shaykh.
After the death of Shaykh al-Bani.
He said Prophet.
Oh, the death of Shaykh al-Bani. Right. After the death of the Shaykh al-Bani, we've seen the book, which is the 12th volume, and the Shaykh actually... after his death, we have now 13 volumes of the Da'ifa. But going back now to the in fact.
In fact, one of the most amazing things to arise from this age and its intellectual anarchy is that one person, Muhammad Isaf Nashashi.
Okay, this is, I'm not going to go to you to read that because it's a refutation of somebody who is a Qur'anic. Basically, he is not really giving any weight for the sunnah. If you want to read it for yourself, but it is a refutation to a person who had, talked about this issue, and he said, we don't have to say Ali Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi Muhammad, just like that. But what we're concerned about is a person that he is trying to understand the Quran separate from the Sunnah. That's what we're concerned about. So we go straight away to the Sheikh Saldani's warning. And I'm going to just tell you, brother, just give me the book of yours. Make sure you do it to read from. So, therefore, beware. There's page 77, the last paragraph, or the last, no, before the last one. Yes, second.
Before paragraph. Number three, the last paragraph of number two. Point.
Okay.
Therefore, beware, O Muslims, of attempting to understand the Quran without recourse to the Sunnah, for you will never be able to do that, even if you were the Sibawai.
Sibawai means the most eloquent Arabic.
Of the age.
Sibawai is the most eloquent person who spoke the Arabic language, which is, grammatically speaking, he's the best. Now,
the expert of the age in Arabic language, Sibawai, of his age. Here is an example in front of you of Nashashibi, is one of the leading scholars of Arabic language of this period. You have seen how he has strayed after being deceived by his knowledge of the language, by not seeking the aid of the Sunnah in understanding Quran. In fact, he has rejected this aid, as you know. There are many other examples of this. There is not enough room here to mention them, but what we have mentioned will suffice, and Allah is the granter of all capability.
The source of the Qur'anis. Qur'anis mean the people, they base their deen upon the Qur'an. And we know that the Muslim has to believe in the Qur'an and the Sunnah the same, on the same level. I mean, just like as much as you believe the Qur'an, you believe in the Sunnah, because both of them are from one source. And for us, the Qur'an and Sunnah, they are together in parallel. None of them is above the other. And the Sheikh, he had took an effort to refute this person because he had an impact at that era. And that is why he was warning against that issue and warning against the Qur'anis. Let's go now to the third one, which is even longer. This is the longest, basically.
Number three
is to do with Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Do we say Sayyidina Muhammad or not? Now.
Number three, the reader will also see that in none of these types of salah on the Prophet.
You have to put a title for that, which is the number three, and that is the rule regarding the addition of Sayyidina in the Salah al-Ibrahimiyya or the Tashahud. I did not bring that title from my pocket, but from the Asl. The rule of adding the word Sayyidina in the Salah al-Ibrahimiyya or in the Tashahud. That's the title of the third benefit, third note. Now,
the reader will also see that in none of these types of Salah on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is there the word Sayyid, the chief leader. The latter scholars have differed about the validity of its inclusion in the Ibrahimi Salah. Due to the lack of space, we will not go into the details of that, nor make mention of those who rejected its validity in keeping with the Prophet ﷺ's complete teaching to the Ummah when he instructed, say, O Allah, send prayers on Muhammad.
What he meant here, that the scholars later on regarding this, they have differed regarding the addition of Sayyidina. And he said, I don't have the capacity now in this book to go and detail the sayings of theirs, but the ones who had said it is not allowed to be said, it's actually to follow the instructions of the Prophet ﷺ, which is complete instruction to his ummah. When he was asked how to pass prayers upon him, he said, commanding them, say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. And let me give you a flavor that is going to come later on. That is, those people, they may say that we are giving more respect and etiquette by adding the word Sayyidina before Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is a question that the Sufis, they, you know, put, is what is the etiquette itself? What is the adab? The adab, is it to put extra in your pocket or to abide by what the Prophet says? So let's say, for example, now, the adhan that we know. So if somebody said in the adhan, instead of saying, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, he said, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or Ashhadu anna Sayyidana Muhammadan. Anna Sayyidana Muhammadan Rasulullah. Okay, he, according to him, he is got more reverence to the Prophet. But actually, no. Because if the etiquette, or the right etiquette, the correct etiquette, is to add to what the Prophet of Allah taught us, then what we say here, you know, the Prophet of Allah, what he taught us, is not an etiquette. The opposite. And that is completely nonsense. So you're going to add now Sayyidina in every... Yeah, you could say as well, if you have as well gave etiquette to the Prophet, more practical to Allah. So instead of saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah in the adhan, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah jalla fi ula. You could add as well, because we have to exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the adhan becomes completely different. It's not like that. So that is why we have no hesitation to say that the Prophet is a Sayyid. And a Sayyid who are the adhan. So he is a saint, but we are followers of the Prophet. إِذَا حَدَّثْتُكُمْ بِحَدِيثٍ فَلَا تَزِيدُنَّ عَلَيْهِ. If I say to you a hadith, do not give extra words. Now, changing the words even is not right when it comes to the adhkar, which are tawqifiyya, meaning they are for ibadah. And I always give you the example of hadith Al-Bara' ibn Azim, radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet ﷺ taught him the dua to go to bed, in which he says, Allahumma wajjahtu wajhi ilayk, wa aslamtu nafsi ilayk, wa fawwadtu amri ilayk, rahbatan wa rahbatan ilayk, la manja wa la manja aminka ila ilayk. Allahumma inni amantu bi kitabika alladhi anzalt, wa bi nabiyika alladhi arsalt. When Al-Bara' started to repeat those words before the Prophet of Allah in order that he would master the memorization, he said it word for word except for one. He said, وَأَمَنْتُ بِنَبِيِّكَ الَّذِي said of نَبِيِّكَ وَبِرَسُولِكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتَ. Changing the word from Nabi, he did not add, like we have here said, Sayyidina Muhammad. So he just changed the word. And from the word Nabi to the Prophet Rasul, there is no much difference in between. Because we know that the Rasul is a greater umbrella, you could say, under which a Prophet and Prophet plus. So every, we know that for a fact, that every Rasul has to be what? Nabi. Okay, every Rasul has to be Nabi. But is every Nabi is a Rasul? Some of the Anbiya, they're not Rusul, they're not. They are not being asked to deliver the message to the non-believers, only to the old believers. Okay, some of the, like Zakaria is a prophet. Yusuf alayhi salam, messenger. So the prophet and the messenger, the difference among the scholars, what is the difference? Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, verily the prophet is the one who is not being given the task to deliver the message to the disbelievers, where the messenger is for the believers and the disbelievers. So in that hadith, Prophet ﷺ, as soon as he had heard him saying, instead of Nabi, Rasul, he had poked him in his chest and he said to him, say Nabi. And the scholars differed, why did the Prophet of Allah say to him, say Nabi? Even though there's not much difference. They said, and the most correct, he could say, an authentic and close saying, Al-Imam Al-Khattabi, as I remember, can remember now, but the most authentic saying regarding this is that those words of the Prophet of Allah, they have secret behind them. So it is like a doctor saying to you, three pills if you have a heart attack. So you have a heart attack, or heart problem, he's got to do three pills, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, one in the evening. So you abide with the doctor's words to the letter. Why? Because in case you're going to what? Kill yourself. Same thing with the Prophet's adhkar. Prophet's adhkar is like those pills and even more that the doctor has prescribed for the person who is in a critical situation. So you, the words, they have secrets behind them. So, An-Nabi, not a Rasul. So he said to him, say An-Nabi. So what we say now, if the Prophet of Allah was concerned about changing the words, he would not be concerned about adding a word. And the Prophet ﷺ, it's not true that he is trying to humble himself and say to them, say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, because he doesn't want to say Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. So that is why the Sufis, they say, for example, that Prophet of Allah did not say that out of humbleness. Well, if it is the case, then why the companions, whom are better than you, did not give that etiquette that you are trying to give? Al-iltizam qimmatul adab. Abiding by what is the instruction is the ultimate adab, the ultimate etiquette, the ultimate manners. And this is what our Shaykh Abu Ishaq al-Huri, Habibullah, when he had met Shaykh al-Albani, rahmatullahi alayhi, the first time. And he was so happy to meet the Shaykh. And the difference in age is huge. So when he had the golden opportunity to come to the house of the Shaykh, and he was dreaming about that, it was a dream. Meaning to get that is almost like impossible. So he went into the Sheikh's house, and the Sheikh had his wife preparing the breakfast. And when she knocked for him, the Sheikh, to go and pick up the tray of breakfast to get it, of course, it was Hatta Huwaini, the Sheikh, he said, I will not tolerate for myself to see the old man Sheikh is my Sheikh too. So I wouldn't straight away, like we do that as well, to go and hold the tray and bring it. So the Sheikh, he said to me, sit down. So Sheikh Abu Ishaq, you know, sat down. Again, she knocked the door to give him the tray for tea. So straight away he is all, he want to help the Sheikh, so he's sort of sprinted or jumped, and he wanted to go on. I mean, this is natural. The Sheikh, he said, sit down. Al-iltizam qimmatul adab. That is, to abide by my instruction is the adab, that you're trying to be adab with me. This is the ultimate adab. Adab is adab, you are really good, but it's not as good as I want. To abide with my words is the adab. So I said to you, sit, you sit. So he sat and he was scared. And he was scared. And he's the one who had narrated that story himself. So and you'll find that as well in YouTube these days if you want to listen to it. Right, so we are abiding by the instruction of the Prophet of Allah who had given to the companions. Say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. He never said to them, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. And there is no such thing as called that he is humble. And that's why he did not mention Sayyid. For when he, the Prophet of Allah, said, Ana Sayyidu waladi Adam. Why he was not humble in that time? I am the most eminent of the son of Adam on the day of resurrection. He was not humble in that time. No. He taught them and he wants them to follow him. He doesn't want them to add anything. Because if you add, as I said, then you open the big gate here. And the adhan will be changed, the iqamah, so Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, subhanAllah, Allah, shudda la ilaha illallah, jalla fi ula, you're gonna add. Shudda Muhammad Rasulullah, shudda Muhammad, shudda wa sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah. So all of that addition is not from the etiquette. Coming now back to the continuation of that, please.
But we, Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, will quote the Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani on this, bearing in mind his position as one of the great Shafi'i scholars of both hadith and fiqh for contradiction of this teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has become widespread among Shafi'i scholars.
And I would like to mention and grab this opportunity to say Ibn Hajar rahimahullah is not al-Ash'ari. This is very important to understand, because some of the people, they accuse him of being an Ash'ari or Imam al-Nawawi. And even some of them, they say, is Ash'ari, whether you like it or don't like it. No, I don't like it. Ash'ariya has to have three principles. If these three principles in him, they have to be together, then he's Ash'ari. But if he's one of them, then we say he's got Ash'ariya, but he's not an Ash'ari. Those three principles, learn them. Number one, the Aql is over the Naql. In all the texts in general, the Aql is over the Naql, meaning the intellect takes priority over the text in everything, even regarding the Aqidah, regarding the... So you have the Aql over the Naql. So if any text comes in, if it goes along with his Aql, he'll accept it. If it does not go without the Aql, then he will see. If it is Hadith, either he would say, oh, it is Daif, bin it, we don't want it. If it is Mutawatir, very strong, he starts to make a reinterpretation for it. Because to match with what? With the Aql. And if it is an Ayah, a verse, they can't say it's weak, but they will reinterpret the Ayah. Because it has to match the Aql. And that is why they made the Ta'wil and the alteration in the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the hand, and so on and so forth. That's the first principle of this. And we challenge any person to bring us a text from the two Imams, Ibn Hajar or Ibn al-Imam al-Nawawi, to say that they make the Aql over the Naql. It's impossible, it's the opposite. You'll find even the Imam Ibn al-Nawawi, a number of his books, he always ridicule those ones who put the Aql over the Naql. No way. The Naql is first. Qala Allah, Qala Rasuluh first. The same thing with Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. So they don't have that principle. From that principle, which is number one, the second and the third are linked to it. So the second principle, that all the texts, save the Quran, from the Hadith of the Prophet, either mutawatir or ahad. This division of verse, okay, mutawatir or ahad, is in order to implement what they want. So they said, in the Aqidah, it has to be mutawatir. And for prayers, Hajj, Sawm, is the Ahad. What is the Ahad? What is the Mutawatir? Mutawatir is a hadith which is narrated in such a way that the hadith narrated by a number of narrators, that there will be impossible if there's a conspiracy or somebody had forged the line. And that is why the whole Quran is Mutawatir. Whereas Ahad means it is being narrated by a number of narrators, not one, it could be two, it could be three or four or five, but they haven't reached the level where there is certainty about it. So they have not reached the level of certainty. And you could ask me how many. This is another issue that we refute their argument. We don't know. So bring us something mutawatir to tell us what is the number of mutawatir. Bring us a mutawatir to tell us what is the number of mutawatir. They haven't got any. So that is why they mention this, as to if the hadith comes in mutawatir, they take it in the aqidah. Now, if that mutawatir goes against the aql, which is number one principle, they will to what? Reinterpret it. We say to them, Prophet ﷺ, he came on his own. He is ahad now. The whole of the Prophet ﷺ is on his own. He did not, but Allah will bring with him, you know, angels along with him to see them and see this mutawatir from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam al-Bukhari, in all his sahih, he started hadith number one, ahad. And hadith number last one is ahad. Just to tell the people, my book is between ahad and ahad, whether you like it or not. The first hadith is ahad, and the last hadith is ahad. So Imam al-Bukhari is telling to the others to say that My book is between Bayna Ahadi. Two hadiths are Ahad. Right, so this is the second principle that which we know that definitely Imam Ibn Hajar and Imam Ibn Nawawi, they haven't got it. Third principle is that the alteration of the hadith, which is mutawatir or ayah, if it is not, you know, they have this, if it does not go with that, the alteration. That's where Ibn Hajar and Imam Nawawi, they were mutadabbibin, fluctuating. They did make an alteration, and even some of the sifat, they did not interpret it. They just said, tafwid. We don't know what's the meaning of it. And we, as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, when we come to the sifat, we will bring them as they are. We know the meaning, but we don't know the how. That's how it is. So, when the person starts making this comparison of the meaning of an attribute and starts to interpret it in a way to want to understand it and making it similar to the creation, that's when he runs away to make the alteration, or at least they make the tafwil. That means we don't know the meaning of it. Ibn Hazm, rahimahullah, we can't call him Jahmi. But he is in the sifat Jahmi. Ibn Hazm, in the attributes of Allah, he's Jahmi. And he's a great scholar. Not to say that his book, Al-Muhalla, scholars, they said that you're not going to be a scholar until you read the Muhalla. Four books to be read, one of them is Al-Muhalla. And one book is Al-Mughni. Al-Muhalla is a great book, but watch out from the words of Ibn Hazm when he starts speaking ill about some of the scholars. But in Muhalla and other books as well, we find that Ibn Hazm, rahmatullahi alayhi, he had avoided to interpret the attributes. And for him, for example, the yad and the shin, the hand and all of that, they have no, they're all of them the same. There's no difference in between them. And that's Ibn Hajar, rahmatullahi alayhi. Ibn Hazm, now. Now, Ibn al-Imam al-Nawawi, in his Sharh Sahih Muslim, he had made some of those interpretations, like for example, al-Dahik. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala smiles, which is a smile suitable to His Majesty. That's what we say. But when you start smiling, includes teeth showing. You know, when people say cheese, smile. But that's nothing to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has to do with you. And the best example for that is the leg of the table. When you say the leg of the table, does that jump to your mind that the leg of the table's got hair and knee and toes? Never ever. The table has a leg which is suitable to its majesty. Do you understand me? The leg of the table has its attributes which is suitable to its nature. So when we have, for example, the shin of Allah, the foot of Allah, which is suitable to His Majesty, why does it jump to your mind? The leg of a table, or the shin of a table, or the leg of a human being, why does it jump to you? Suitable to Allah Azza wa Jal. So don't run. And that's the safest method. نُجْرِيهَا كَمَاكَ. And that is where Allah لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. The amount of the oath of the Prophet ﷺ, he had said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ. As I said, more than 90% of the oaths of the Prophet, by the one in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad. It's like in every hadith, he's saying this, he's refuting the Ash'ara. Saying, you're wrong. If the hand means power, why should the Prophet ﷺ always making this oath? By the power of Allah, by the power of which Allah has got Muhammad ﷺ's soul? It doesn't work. By the one in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad. So in this, that is, we confirm the hand of the Prophet of Allah, and at the same time, it could be the hand in that particular text means the power or the blessing. لَتْ يَدُ اللَّهِ فَوْقَ أَيْدِيهِمْ. The hand of Allah is over their hands. Now we as an Arab, we understand that means Allah is supporting them. But he used the word hand because Allah's got a hand. That's the one which solved your problem. So we attribute the hand to Allah, but at the same time, this hand means the power. It doesn't mean that Allah's hand, like my hand, is on top of your hands. Okay? So when we say in English, can I give you a hand? You could give him a foot, isn't it? True or not? So you give him a foot. Could give him, can I give you a hand means what? Can I give you what? Help. But do you have a hand or not? So you attribute it to, now you confirm that you have a hand. And at the same time, you have given, not ta'wil, this is the proper meaning. This is what the misunderstanding of the shayah. You didn't make ta'wil to the hand. Hand, you give a hand, give a hand. The expression every English person means, can I give you a help? It doesn't, can I give you a hand? I cut my hand, I give it to you. Can I give you a hand? Who says that? Same thing with Arabic. Okay? By the one whose hand is the sword of Muhammad. Well, it doesn't come to our mind as an Arab that Allah is in his hand holding the sword of Muhammad. By the one in whose hand is the sword of Muhammad. It doesn't come to our mind at all. This is the Arabic language. But at the same time, Allah had put the hand because he's got a hand. Suitable to his majesty. We don't know how the hand looked like. Simple as that. Now.
Hafiz Muhammad ibn Muhammad, al-Gharabili.
Al-Gharabili. Al-Gharabili.
A companion of Ibn Hajar.
He said, Rahimahullah, and the Shaykh al-Albani took that from his manuscript which he found in al-Maktab al-Zahiri. He says, and Ibn Hajar, he was asked.
He, Ibn Hajar, Rahimahullah, was asked about the features of the Salah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whether during prayer or outside it, compulsory or recommended. Is one of its conditions that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam be attributed with Sayyada, the leadership?
Siyada. So like he's saying, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, or upon Sayyidul Khalq, or Sayyidi Waladi Adam, or should he
stick to Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, or Allah send prayers on Muhammad?
And which is better?
Which of the two is better approach, including the word Sayyid, due to it being an established attribute of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?
That means knowing the Sayyid, or
leaving it out due to the absence of it in the narrations.
Okay. So what did he say?
He, Ibn Hajar Rahimahullah, replied.
He said, Rahimahullah, that's from the translator. He's trying to correct. But he could have just said, you see, Muhammad al-Gharabili, he did not put Rahimahullah, he said Rabbi Allah.
Okay.
Did he say Rahimahullah?
Because I was just reading.
So it's actually the reader who was reading, altering the words. La tu'awwi ya akhi. I didn't know that.
May Allah be pleased with him.
Yes. Okay, so that you're trying to correct what he said, but may Allah be pleased with him. We could find it, because radiallahu anhu, it could be of two meanings. Meaning that Allah is pleased with him, or may Allah be pleased with him. So if it's may Allah be pleased with him, that's good. But the companions, Allah is, or is pleased with him. But you could radiallahu anhu, that means Allahumma yarda. So, but this is an expression, we would make it better to stick it to the companions.
Rahmanullah, replied, yes, to follow the narrated wording is superior. It cannot be said, maybe the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself did not say it out of modesty, just as he did not say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on mention of his name, although his ummah has been encouraged to do so. For we say that if that were superior, it would have been quoted from the companions, radiallahu anhum, and then from the successors, but we do not come across it in any narrations from any companion or successor.
If you add radiallahu anhum, don't add radiallahu anhum. Just read, please, doctor.
Okay.
Because when you're adding something which is not right, okay, there's no radiallahu anhum sahaba there.
No.
Okay. Don't just read what is there. Jazakallah. Poet.
This is despite the volume of quotations from them. We have Imam Shafi, may Allah exalt his rank, one of the foremost among men in his respect for the Prophet ﷺ, saying in the preface to his book, which is a base for the people
the
of
book is Al-Bum, Kitab Al-Bum, the book of Al-Bum.
No. And he wrote, O Allah, send prayers on Muhammad, etc. until the end of what is judgment dictated. Every time one of the remembrance, one of the rememberers remembers him.
No, I don't think you're really making a sense out of this sentence. Let me just translate it and you can see that you're translating right, right. It says here that the Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, and he was the most, one of the most people who were showing sheer reverence to the Prophet ﷺ. He said in the introduction of his book, the which is the foundation of the madhab of Shafi'i, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, until the end of what his ijtihad told him to say. And that is what he said. Kullama dhakarahu dhakirun. Every time the ones who mention him, they mention him. كلما غفل عن ذكره الغافلون. And every time the ones who are people who are oblivious to mention him. So it looks like that he had taken this from the authentic hadith that contains Subhanallah adada khalqi, glory to be to Allah, the number of his creation. For that it has been established that the Prophet ﷺ, he said to the mother of the believers, and he had Sawha, she was making tasbih, and she had made a long tasbih, that he said to her, I have said words after you, if they're to be weighed with what you have said, it would be weighing them out. So, and he had mentioned that. And the Prophet ﷺ used to like the concise dua, meaning dua was a short. I have translated what I believe is correct. If it matches, yeah, then it's correct. Go ahead.
Next.
Yes.
Qadi Iyad set out a chapter about Salah on the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in his book Ash-Shifa, the Book of Cure, quoting in it narrations from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on the authority of several companions and successors. In none of these is the word Sayyid reported.
But can I just understand what you have to understand with Imam Shafi'i? He did not put Sayyidina. He said, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, to the end, which is Allah ala Muhammad. But he put, kama dhakarahu dhakirun. This is from ijtihad, based upon the hadith. O Lord, have glory to be to Allah, the number of his creation. عدد خلق. No.
None of these reports have the Sayyid, number one. The hadith of Ali, that he used to teach them the manner of salah on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by saying,
Allahumma lahi al-mad'uwat wa bari al-masbukat ij'al sabiqa salawatika wa nawami wa barakatika wa zairi tahiyyatika ala Muhammadin abdika wa rasulika al-fatih lima aghlaq. Na'am. Aw ughliq. Na'am.
Translation of Allah, spreader of plains, originator of heights, send the foremost of your prayers, the most fertile of your blessings.
Anyway, there is no Sayyidina in all of it. Yeah, Ali Muhammad. Also, he says.
B, again from Ali.
All of it, there's got no Sayyid. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud.
On the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, they used to say, oh Allah,
no,
send
no
your
Sayyid
prayers.
Well. Al-Hasan al-Basri.
Whoever wants to drink from the cup which quenches from the fount of Al-Mustafa should say, oh Allah, send prayer on Muhammad and on his family.
Then he said, the brother of, yes, it was narrated from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud that he used to say in his salah upon the Prophet ﷺ, Allahumma ja'al fada'ila salawatika wa rahmatika wa barakatika ala Sayyidin Mursalin. He mentioned that. But this hadith is unauthentic. From Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, it is unauthentic. Right, now, I'm not going to go more than that regarding this issue. So the most complete salah upon the Prophet is the way the Prophet of Allah taught us without the addition of Sayyidina. Now, benefit four, please.
Number four, it should be known that types number one and four,
and I'm going to read them myself, type one and number four. Number one, that the salah, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ahli bayti wa ala azwaji wa dhurriyyati kama sallaita ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. Wabarak ala Muhammad wa ala ahli bayti wa ala azwaji wa dhurriyyati kama barakta ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. And number 4 is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad an-nabiy al-ummi wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala ali Ibrahim. Wabarak ala Muhammad an-nabiy al-ummi wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala ali Ibrahim fil alamin innaka Hamidum Majid. Go ahead.
So these are the ones which Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught his companions when they asked about the manner of salah on him. So this has been used as evidence that these are the best ways of doing the salah on him, for he would not choose anything for them or himself except the best and noblest. Imam An-Nawawi, as mentioned, endorsed in Rawda al-Talibin.
That means he had corrected what he believes is correct.
That if a man were to take an oath to do the best possible salah on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this could not be fulfilled except in these ways.
That means this is the best of salah. So if somebody said to you, salli ala nabi, you say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. Like this. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. In our country, the people, they have this habit. If one person wants to interrupt you from talking, he wants to, you know, jump in and cut you off and start himself initiating the talk, he would say, Salli ala nabi, Salli ala nabi. What are you talking? Salli ala nabi, that means shut up, so I could really talk. Salli ala nabi, Salli ala nabi. So you have to stop, and then you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As soon as you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you have this opportunity to start his talk straight away. So salli ala nabi. So the best remedy for such thing, when you say to him, Salli ala Nabi, and you know that he doesn't want me to Salli ala Nabi, first of all, you say to him, please make salutation with me. Because he say it to you, you say it as well. And number two, to make him boil, it's okay. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. He's waiting now. Ala ali Muhammad, kima sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ibrahim. He wants to talk, say, brother, I have to finish my salat. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. كَمَا بَرَكْتَ عَلَى إِبْرَهِيمُ وَعَلَى إِبْرَهِيمُ إِنَّكَ حَمِيدٌ مَجِيدٌ. Believe me, he will never ask you to make salutation upon the Prophet again. He'll be just quiet. And this is a remedy, and I said, this is a trend, this is something that is happening all the time. You talk to the عَنْكُوَ يَا شَيْخُ الْمَغْرَبَ عَنْكَلَمْ صَلَّى عَنْ نَبِي يَنْهِي أُسْكُرْ. You've got the
problem in Morocco as well. Subki has given another reason. Whoever does salah with those types has made salah on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with certainty, and whoever does so with other words is in doubt whether or not he has performed the prayer as requested.
Okay, listen now, we'll go to the fifth one, we'll finish. What does that mean?
Number 5,
no.
It should be known that it is not valid to combine all these way into one way of salah.
Meaning you cannot just put one dua, lump it with the second dua, and make your own dua. So example now, I'm making mixture between number 4 and number 5. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, abdika wa rasulika, al-nabiyu al-ummi, wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala ali Ibrahim, wa barik ala Muhammad, abdika wa rasulika, al-nabiyu al-ummi. I'm actually making from 4 and 5 a dua by adding words from the 4, putting them into the 5. I cannot do that. I have to stick to one of those and alternate, which is the sunnah, to say this and that and this and that, that's better, but not to mix up things. Now,
number 6, Allama Siddiq Hassan Khan says in his book, Nuzul al Abrar bil Ilm al Mathur min al Adariya wa Adkar.
Which one you find? Number 5?
Number 6.
Oh, number 6, sorry. You finished number 5. Okay, number 6. You haven't said. And this is a bid'ah in the deen, forbidden the sunnah to say this, to say that, as Shaykh al-Islam to me had said. This is very important to know, Shaykh al-Islam. Right, now we go to number 6. I didn't go to number 6.
Okay. Number 6, Allama Siddiq Hassan Khan says in his book,
Nuzul al-Abrar bil-ilm al-Ma'thur bil-Adiyati wal-Adhkar. Now,
after giving many hadith about the excellence of repeated
salah, Fadl salati ala nabi,
that there is no doubt that the foremost among the Muslims in sending salah on him sallallahu alaihi wasallam are the people of hadith.
Okay, and so this note, which is the last one, is to say the people of hadith, the ones who are the scholars who had employed all their life in the hadith, those are the ones who are being deserved to be the closest to the Prophet ﷺ, because they live with the breath of the Prophet ﷺ. They live with the words of the Prophet ﷺ. So every time they read a hadith, they say, "Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam." So the smallest book, for example, from the hadith, Al-Jami' al-Saghir, it's got 10,000 hadith. Imagine the scholar, Imam Suyuti, when he had mentioned that, and written that 10,000. So every time he says, "Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam," Qala Rasulullah, 10,000 times just for his book. So he says that definitely this is the group which the Prophet ﷺ talked about, the saved sect. Those are al-Firqa al-Najiyah, and those are the Ta'if al-Mansura, prevailing group as well, on the day of resurrection, and they are the ones who are most deserved to the intercession of the Prophet ﷺ. The Shaykh wrote this to say, "I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make me one of those, that is, who will be having the more priority from the people with the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam." Now, he had mentioned some of the poetry of Imam Ahmad. Dinu Nabi Muhammadin akhbaru ni'ma al-matiyah lil fata atharu la targhaban 'an al-hadith wa ahlihi fara'u layl wal hadith naharu wa la rubbama jahila al-fata athara al-huda wa shamsu bazighatun laha anwar. Now, I cannot translate that into the English, which would the rhyme, but let's see what he has done.
The religion of Muhammad is in narrations. The best mounts for a young man are the traditions.
The traditions? No, it is actually the hadiths. So it is, if the deen of the Prophet is, you know, narrations, the best of the thing for the youth is the narrations itself.
Turn not away from hadith and its people, for opinion is night, while hadith is day.
So opinion is dark, and the hadith is light. Now,
a young man can be ignorant of the guidance.
Ignorant from the guidance. Yes.
Although the sun is shining in all its splendor.
Meaning that the hadith people are, just like the sun is clear, those people are clear. Right. Last thing. After that, finished. After the
dua,
poetry is
finished.
First part of Tashahhud, inshallah, we'll come back to you, inshallah, next week. If you have any questions, please go ahead. Dua, Tashahhud, inshallah, next week. Tadab. Talking about the ayat. You mean the two tashahud? Which tashahud? Different? No problem. As long as not in one tashahud. So, the first tashahud you're doing one version, second tashahud, second version. No problem about that. Yeah, same thing. Tahiyat, you could alternate, and the prayer, you could alternate. This is called salutation, tashahud. Another one's called Salah. You could alternate here, you could alternate here. What he had mentioned in number 5 is to make a dua from those 6 that he's been mentioned and putting words, addition from here to there. For example, from the ones that you have seen, there is one, each, I think it's number 4. There is Fil Alameena Innaka Hamidun Majid. If you put Fil Alameena, the word, onto number 1, that's called not right, talfiq. So if you put fil alamina, which is in the number 4, into number 1, instead of innaka hamidun majid, say fil alamina, innaka hamidun majid, you have made talfiq. That means you have created your own dua, which is not right. Now, tafadhal. Yes?
There's no
There is no difference between the first tashahhud and the last tashahhud. There is. You're asking me number 1 and number 7, you're asking me about, oh, we see, I'm coming back, I think you're talking about the, There is no difference between number tashahhud number one, tashahhud number two. The hadith, which is in Muslim and Ahmad, and also in the books of the Sunnah, كَانَ رَسُولَ سَلَّمْ إِذَا جَلَسَ فِي الرَّكَعَتَيْنِ Prophet ﷺ, he sit in the two rak'ah, كَأَنَّهُ عَلَى الْغِذْفِ is like onto the burning coal, is unauthentic. So this is the one that some of the scholars have depended upon to make that the first tashahhud is much shorter in time than the second tashahhud, which is unauthentic. Now, even some of the scholars say, even if it's authentic, it doesn't mean that you don't say the prayers upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It doesn't mean that. It could mean, for example, you don't say the dua, which is after the prayer of the Prophet of Allah. But the prayer, which is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, where is the proof to say that you could say it, you only say it in the first tashahhud, and you don't say it in the second tashahhud? For verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Allah and his angels making the salah upon the Prophet. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. So this is a general, you have to make salah on the Prophet who had specified it between to number two, which is tashahhud number two, not tashahhud number one. So they are equal, wallahu a'lam, in terms of lengthwise. Now, tafaddal. Which madhab that agrees that both tashahhud are the same? None of the madhabs. And when I say none of the madhabs, I'm not saying talking about the madhab of Imam Malik, Imam Abu Hanifa, sorry, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad Muhammad. That's the Imam. But if you're talking about madhab in any scholars, there are a number of scholars who say that. But when he said madhab, I said none of the madhab. And we have a number of issues which you bind yourself with, and none of them have said. So for example, we know that the person regarding his divorce, that if the person divorces his wife three times, divorce, according to the former madhab, she's completely divorced that in Bayunah Kubra. That means she cannot go back to you until she marries somebody else and that person dies or he divorces her. But you know that the fact that those people, regardless of their madhab, they would abandon their madhab when it comes to this issue, because he wants to get his wife back, so he would go to the Ibn Taymiyyah madhab. So if you said madhab Ibn Taymiyyah, yes, Ibn Taymiyyah, he says it. Ibn Qayyim, he says it. But the madhabs, or the form of that, they don't say it. But none of the madhabs say it, because they did not have the ahadith, which is hadith Aisha radiallahu anha, which is, I remember, quoted to you in the Witr prayer, in the seventh rak'ah, the sixth and the seventh tashahhud, the sixth rak'ah he made tashahhud, the seventh rak'ah he made tashahhud, both of them he made dua, which is a very great thing, which means that they are the same. And you know as well, in general, that the principle is that the first tashahhud is like the second tashahhud, unless there is something to say otherwise. So there is, if a Prophet of Allah, he made the tashahhud, the first, and he made the tashahhud in the second. None of those companions had narrated whatsoever that the Prophet of Allah was in the first tashahhud, shorter in time. Or in the first tashahhud, he mentioned only the tashahhud, did not mention the salah upon the Prophet. None of them. So you could say the principle is that both tashahhud are supposed to be the same. If you want to say the first tashahhud is shorter, you need to bring one, a proof. They brought a proof, but that proof is unauthentic. That proof is unauthentic. Which is the Prophet of Allah, he says that كَانَ عَلَى غُطْفِ It's like he's on a burning coal. But even the scholars who said suppose it is authentic, it doesn't mean that you don't say the prayers upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's just like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith of Aisha in the Sunnah al-Fajr, she said he hardly read the Fatiha. That means he did not read the Fatiha. No, he read the Fatiha, but it means that in that particular time, when he was reciting the Sunnah al-Fajr, he was so fast compared to the time when he spends on other Sunnah or other Fajr. That's what it means. But it doesn't mean he did not read the Fatiha. Now. Fadal. In the middle, in the between the two sajda, we did not add. This is a supplication from the Prophet ﷺ. What is the narration? If the narrator is the same, but he had mentioned here something, and he mentioned something else, then you add, because it's not really good to make them different du'as. And it's only the people of hadith can do that. So when you, for example, have a narration from a person, same one, and the same person had said the narration, and the same person regarding this issue, and one has one word, the other one has an extra word, the third word, they don't make them three du'as. You make them one du'a and you add these words. And that's why the Shaykh al-Albani, you could see, I don't know if you got the brackets in your book or not, in those, yeah, you got brackets. Those are brackets. Why? Because they have been taken from other narrations from the same narrator, but he had mentioned here more words. He remembered more words than he remembered in the first time. Or the ones who had narrated from him remembered more words than the ones who had narrated from him from the other side. One incident took place, just to show you that how the companions would really make sure that they are always documenting. For example, Abu Darda, he says, أوصاني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بتسع. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he had given me 9 recommendations. He started with the word 9 in order to make sure he's going to document 9. So if he misses one, he would try what? To remember it. Then the hadith from the companions, he said, Abu Hurairah, that is عَشْرٌ مِنَ الْفِطْرَةِ 10 is from the fitrah. He mentioned 9, he said the 10, I've forgotten it. نُسِّيْتُهَا. So he said, so he had mentioned this 10, but I forgot what? What is the 10th from the Sunnah al-Fitrah? Shutayr ibn Shakil, one of the great followers, him and the other companion Mas'ud, both are students of Allah Mas'ud. When they started mentioning a hadith that they have learned from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah Mas'ud, he said to Shutayr, he said, shall you go ahead and say what you have heard from Abdullah, our teacher, and I will say confirmed in front of the people? Or shall I say what I've heard from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, our teacher, and you say confirmed? So Shutayr, he said, no, you say it and I will confirm. So he started saying what Allah Masud had said. And he would say, confirmed. Yes, I've heard this from Allah Masud. Why he said that? So that the people are sitting around, that they will have from Abdullah Masud two routes of narrations. One from Masruq and one from Shutayr. So that is why. And that is would add more power to the what? To the hadith. More power to the narration. Now, uncle, you have a question?
I've got 2 questions. Hot topic.
Oh, uncle, there's not, the topic is always there.
Can you advise us, please, on these 2 questions? A 16-year-old girl says to her mum, Mum, you're a nurse. Can you prescribe a drug for me so that I do not have my menses every month? How should we approach this problem?
A 16-year-old girl, Muslim girl, she's studying her mom, she wants to take drugs.
She wants to have a drug.
Yeah, to take drugs, tablets, I mean, not drugs and drugs, and yeah, to take tablets, medicine, so she cannot have
her menses.
Permanently? Does that happen scientifically?
She's going to have a lot of physical issues that side
effects. We'll say, first of all, and it's an advice. Okay, first of all, if it was scientifically not harmful, we don't have anything to say about that. So if she can say to her daughter, bring me from any doctor you like, a paper to say it's 100% safe, not 99.9, then you could have it, no problem, I'll give you the pill. If you want to do that, you know, have the pill. Because having the pill and postponing it, the scholars never said anything regarding the issue of a woman going to Hajj and having established in order to postpone or to stop the menses, at least for the time that she goes to the Hajj, so she will not have to interrupt the journey of the people by staying there. There's no scholar that said no for that, but they say that these tablets has to have no side effects. If the side effects are minor, no problem. But here the doctor is saying that it's a big issue. It's going to be big issues. So my dear daughter, she's 16 years old, you are actually committing suicide slowly. You're killing yourself with a slow poison. And if you are worried about your prayer, you want to pray more, is that because of that you don't want to have menses? Or is it because you want to fast more? Okay, or you want to be, for example, not to be in pain, believe me, when you take these tablets, you're going to be in more pain. And Allah's Messenger, he had said to Aisha radiallahu anha, when she had menses, and also Asma bint Umais, when she had menses, that when she was crying because she had menses, she thought she was going to miss the Hajj now. So the Prophet of Allah, he said to her, to Aisha, don't worry, this is something. Let me just switch off that thing, it's beginning again. It is, you see the difference? A lot. So he said to her, verily, that this is something prescribed on the daughters of Adam. Shay'un katabahu Allahu ala banati Adam. So this is something prescribed. Why are you crying? Why are you worried? And if you think that the people at the time of the Prophet did not have the pill to stop the menses, you're wrong. There is medicine called al-Iraq. They used to drink it in order to postpone their what? Menses. So they do have that, the Arab. They know that. And it was liquid. But now all these companies, they made a small little sort of fancy tablet and they sell it to you, God knows, or to the NHS or whatever. Free now? In this country it's free. Yeah. This country is free, man. Our country is not free. Free, but yeah, but it's not free. Yeah. So everything's free. Contraceptive free, everything free on. And Allah. Anything to do with the sex is free. Allah musta'an. that question, Uncle, second question.
Thank you for the first answer. Recently we had a storm.
Storm?
A storm, yes. Yeah. And we had clouds from about 90 miles an hour. The wind. The piece of wood was blown from somewhere and it hit a woman, a 39-year-old woman.
SubhanAllah.
And she bled a lot and died on the spot.
Where? Here? In Luton?
Wolverhampton,
okay.
There are two parts of this question. One is, the woman has an English name. What will happen to her on the day of judgment? And the second one is...
She has an English name, that means she's a disbeliever or a believer? I don't know.
She has an English name. That's all
right. Okay.
The second one, what if that woman was a Muslim woman and she didn't have the time to say La ilaha illallah?
Well, regardless of the story of Uncle, the 90 miles gusting wind, okay, regardless of that story, we said if a person, let's say, dropped dead on the road without that 90 miles an hour, if he's a disbeliever, meaning having an English name, it doesn't mean you're a disbeliever, Uncle. Okay? We have amongst us here somebody who's called John. And he's a believer. We believe he's a believer. So if John dies, we say, if John dies, I mean, come down to your mother, Catholic person. So if the person is a disbeliever, then we treat him as a disbeliever. Now if, for any reason, he has an excuse, that is on the day of resurrection, that's not for me. But for me, he's a disbeliever. On the day of resurrection, maybe he did not receive the message properly. Maybe he had heard it from distorted, you know, sources. Maybe he was a believer inside, but he didn't know what to embrace Islam. That is on the day of resurrection. But for me, I will treat him according to what I have seen him, to what he's been known. So he will be not washed, he will be not shrouded, he will be buried. But not I will bury him, but if there's nobody to bury him, I will bury him. Because as a human being, I will bury him. Like we bury those, even the enemies of ours in the battlefield, we bury them. Prophet of Allah, he buried those war criminals. In the Battle of Badr. He threw them in the well because there are too many to dig. He threw them in the well because to bury them. Because he doesn't want to leave them for the animals to snatch them and everything. Even though they're war criminals now. Prophet of Allah, even when he threw them, started talking to them and rebuking them. If he's a believer, it doesn't matter whether he says La ilaha illallah at the end or he did not. It doesn't matter. So somebody that died like me or you died without saying La ilaha illallah, it doesn't mean that we are no good. But if we said La ilaha illallah and we died, that means it's good. But it doesn't mean you're not good if you did not say La ilaha illallah. For value. Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, we know that he died. He did not say La ilaha illallah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he died. We don't know that he said La ilaha illallah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. He said, for Rafiq al-A'la. For Rafiq al-A'la, with the highest companions. But the Prophet of Allah, he said, he who dies with La ilaha illallah on his lips before he departs, دخل الجنة ولا يوم من الدهر. He will enter paradise, regardless, even one day. He will enter paradise. So, this is from the good signs, uncle. From the good signs is to die on Jumu'ah, whether the night or the day. But the Prophet did not die on Jumu'ah. He did not die on Jumu'ah. He died on Monday. Sorry, Al-Ithnain, not Monday. Al-Ithnain, which is Monday, Al-Ithnain. He was born on Al-Ithnain and he died on what? Al-Ithnain. And he died on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal, which they celebrate his birth on it. They celebrate actually his death, not his birth. Right, that's a solid question, uncle. And I would like to have one last question for the people. So the people who have come from, maybe I'll give you another one quickly, Ahmed.
I just want to make sure what you said that Shaykh al-Bayhaq was said beforehand about reciting the Maliki and the Maliki and the Maliki. Was it that regardless of your...
Regardless of your rotation, you could say Maliki or Maliki. JazakAllah khair for a short question. So could give me time now? Okay, if an imam stood up to make a fifth rak'ah and you are behind him, what are you going to do? You know, what are you going to do? You're sleeping in salah? SubhanAllah. Okay, SubhanAllah. What is he supposed to do? What is he supposed to do if you say SubhanAllah? To sit down, isn't it? So you did not sit down. What are you going to say? SubhanAllah. So he did not sit down. So what do you think now? He stood up because he wants to add a rak'ah, or do you think that he is actually totally messed up? He doesn't know. Why did he say SubhanAllah? He never came to his mind that he's doing a fifth rak'ah. Which one of the two options? Do you think he's doing it deliberately, fifth rak'ah, this imam? No. There's no maybe, 100%. Because if you deliberately doing fifth rak'ah, I'm not going to follow him even the whole prayer. What is this type of this? You could be drunk. But if I know 100% that he's doing out of mistake, so now we're going to answer this question. Imagine now, full masjid. This one, mashallah. And our imam, Abdul Khalid, Sheikh Abdul Khalid, is in his fifth rak'ah. The whole masjid, the one behind, subhanAllah. Actually, the one behind, they don't say subhanAllah. The subhanAllah comes from the back. It's not supposed to be from the one back, but really from the back row. SubhanAllah! SubhanAllah! So maybe the imam was going to be, he doesn't know what to do. But he said, what do you have done now? So he doesn't know sometimes. Let's say he can do the fifth rak'ah. So, according to what you believe is correct, do we sit down and wait for him? Or do we stand with him? If you sat down, person came and he looked at this. What's this? The imam is sitting down and everybody's standing up. What is going on here? What type of prayer? Even if the imam was incapable of standing up, you have to sit what? Down with the imam. And the Prophet of Allah told the companions off. Why? When he saw them praying, standing up, and he was what? Sitting. Kittum, you're almost, and taf'alu ma taf'alu room ma'a mulukihim. That is, you're almost done with the rooms they do with their kings. They stand, they sit down and their people stand up on them. Don't do that. If the imam says, pray sitting down, you pray sitting down. So when the Prophet of Allah, he says, when the Prophet he says, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُؤْتَمَ بِهِ. Verily the imam is to be made, to be followed. You think it is only in the correct? Okay. If the imam in the middle tashahhud, he forgot it. and he went up fully complete. What do you say to him? Subhanallah. Is he allowed to sit down? No. But you have to say Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Maybe before he completed stand up, he will sit down, but he did not. He fully stood. So he should continue. Do you now go with him? You make your tashahhud. No, no, no. Follow him. Tahiyyatulillah, salawatu tayyibat. Do you follow him or you don't follow him? Say you follow him. You follow him in the fifth rak'ah as well. But that's a correct opinion. Subhanakallah, bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.